Hello, Lakers Nation. It's game day, Lakers versus 76ers tonight. We also have a trade rumor to get into involving Bojan Bogdanovic bringing a friend with him to the Los Angeles Lakers. I'm Trevor Lane. You can find me on Twitter at Trevor_Lane, over on Instagram at TrevorLaneNBA. Join us for Lakers versus Sixers tonight over on Playback. Use the link in the description below. Come watch the game directly with us. Joining me is Mark Gunnels from LakersNation.com. Mark, Bojan Bogdanovic. Is that the guy you think the Lakers should try to go get if they can bring in a wing with his shooting ability?
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. I mean, you look at LeBron's career, it's made up of having guys like him, right? Guys with size that can shoot the ball very well. He's shooting 41% from three so far this year. He leads the Pistons in scoring at 21 points a game. So I think if it makes sense, that he's a guy that can definitely elevate this offense and, you know, make it more unpredictable. Right now you have a guy that can stretch the floor. They can't just streak inside and dare guys to shoot. When you have a guy like that on the outside, he'll instantly be this team's best shooter without question.
Oh yeah, immediately. The second he stepped on the floor, he would be their best shooter. I've got a little bit concerns about the age, you know, 34 years old. I believe in March coming up by playoff time, he would be 34. So if the Lakers are looking for a long-term fit, that could be a bit of a challenge. But according to Howard Beck of Sports Illustrated, he was on a podcast recently and said, I've heard the Lakers and Pistons have discussed a deal which would include both Bogdanovic and Nerlens Noel. Since the Pistons are demanding draft assets in any deal for Bogdanovic, it's a given the Lakers would have to surrender a first-round pick to make a deal. Maybe they make a second deal to fortify the rotation further. Will they be willing to trade both picks that are currently trade eligible? The sense around the league is they won't, but we'll see. Nerlens Noel, I mean, interesting inclusion in this. He has not played a ton, was battling plantar fasciitis earlier this season, has appeared in 12 games so far this season, only played in 25 last season. Not exactly the picture of health over his last few NBA seasons. Of course, his career started off missing his rookie season due to injury. So this is not a player who has stayed healthy for the bulk of his career. If he's healthy, he can at least provide some rim protection. So perhaps that's something that's of interest to the Lakers. We know they've been auditioning bigs, DeMarcus Cousins, Myers Leonard coming in for workouts for them. But Mark, what do you think? It's a little bit of a head scratcher to me to see Nerlens Noel thrown in there.
Yeah, it is. But I can understand it from this perspective. I mean, the Lakers have been trying out centers lately. So obviously they're looking for another big, another guy for depth. He's a rim runner. Like you said, a guy that could protect the rim, get some rebounds. He's athletic still. He's not that old. So, I mean, I understand the logic, especially if the main part of the deal would obviously be getting Bogdanovic. And then if you get him as a throw-in, you know, he's still a young guy with some upside. I mean, the guy was a lottery pick at one point. It seems like forever now from Kentucky. But, I mean, like you say, he hasn't played that much. But maybe the thinking is, well, okay, he should be healthy for the stretch run at this point. So, you know, I wouldn't hate it at this point.
He's still just 28 years old. So, I mean, it's not like he's over the hill or anything here. But let me give you my theory. And that's all this is. This is just a theory about what may have been going on in this negotiation. So what I think, because what we've heard so far is that the Lakers made an offer to the Pistons for Bogdanovic, essentially Patrick Beverley, Kendrick Nunn, and a heavily protected first-round pick for Bogdanovic. The Pistons said, no, we want an unprotected first-round pick for Bogdanovic. That's what we're looking for. Now there's rumors out there that the Pistons want an unprotected pick plus maybe something else, like a young player, rotation player, something like that. Anyway, everybody's asking for the moon right now on the trade market. It's one of the big problems on the trade market right now is that prices are so high, it could prevent deals from getting done. But that is a totally different story. So what I think could have happened here, and perhaps maybe this is still the route it goes, is if you're going to add in Nerlens Noel, who has a salary of over $9 million, right? You can't just trade Patrick Beverley and Kendrick Nunn for Nerlens Noel and Bogdanovic. You have to throw in salary. You have to add salary into the mix in order to make it work. So here's what I think the Lakers do. You make it Lonnie Walker, Patrick Beverley, Kendrick Nunn for Nerlens Noel and Bogdanovic. And you're doing two things there. You're accomplishing two things. You're adding value in two ways. You're giving the Pistons a young wing. You don't have bird rights on. The Pistons wouldn't have bird rights on him, but at least he's a young wing player that they can take a look at in Lonnie Walker. If you're the Lakers, you can say, well, Bogdanovic is probably going to take Lonnie's spot in the rotation anyway. He's going to get paid next summer. We don't know if we can retain him. Bogdanovic is still under contract, right? There's some pros to making that swap. There's some cons too. I like what we've seen out of Lonnie, but that's a way you can add value. On top of that, If you add Nerlens' salary to the deal at just over $9 million, Lonnie is just over $6 million. So what you're doing is you're adding salary savings. In the original deal, Bogdanovic for Nunn and Patrick Beverley, the Pistons are chopping off like about $1 million or so. When you add in a Nerlens Noel and Lonnie Walker swap into this deal, make it a bigger trade, suddenly the Pistons are saving closer to $4 million on the deal. So now if you're the Lakers, you could say, okay, Pistons, well, we don't want to lower our pick protections that much. We don't want to give you an unprotected pick because who knows where we're going to be in 2027, 2029, whatever, right? We still want to have protections on this pick, but we're going to give you a little bit more value on the deal by adding in Lonnie Walker, a young wing you can look at. And look, you're going to save more money now because we're adding those pieces into the deal. And again, I don't think the deal would necessarily be about getting Nerlens Noel. I would imagine that the inclusion of Noel, it's about adding value to the deal for the Pistons without necessarily decreasing those pick protections or not decreasing them too much. That's my guess, Mark. I don't know if that's enough to get the deal done. I know Bogdanovic is in high demand. There's going to be a bidding war for him, and it probably goes all the way up until the February 9th deadline. The Pistons are continuing to tell people they don't want to trade him. But that's my guess, Mark. And if it comes down to that, Lonnie, Nunn, Pat, and a protected first for Bogdanovic and Noel, are you doing that deal?
Yes. Yes. Because here's the thing. And the fact that it's protected, that's the big turning point for me. But also, let's keep it real. LeBron's window is very, very small right now. And it's always been this debate of whether do you sacrifice the future for this year? Because do you still have even a chance to win it this year? I think the Lakers have shown enough without AD that if you bring in AD back and you make a deal that they can compete in the West. Because we talked about it before. There's not one clear, just dominant team in the West. The one seed right now is what, Denver? And you played them really good without being at full strength. So I don't see it to where it's like, okay, just give it up. Season's over with. You're not going to make any noise. No, if you can get AD back, you make this trade, and you get in the playoffs, and you're healthy, I would like the Lakers' chances against anybody in the West. I'm not saying they're going to come out the West, but I'm just saying they will have a puncher's chance if healthy come playoff time.
Right, but they got to get there. They got to get to the playoffs. Yeah. Obviously, that double overtime loss to the Mavs, I thought there, massive mistakes by the referees that changed the outcome of the game, both at the end of regulation and at the end of single overtime. Results in a Lakers loss. Again, Lakers made plenty of mistakes as well. That one hurts. Now you've got to bounce back. And you've got to figure out a way tonight to get a win against a tough 76ers side. But the 76ers are coming off the second night of a back-to-back. James Harden and Tobias Harris, both questionable to play in this game. Tobias Harris did not play last night against the Utah Jazz. James Harden did and played a lot of minutes. And so there's thought that he may not go in this one tonight against the Lakers. For the Lakers side, of course, oh boy, here the tidal wave of injuries. Austin Reeves, Anthony Davis, Lonnie Walker, Patrick Beverley still out as well. He'll be missing due to illness once again. Lakers announced that just a few hours ago. But the 76ers, as a result of all this uncertainty, just a three-point favorite, which on the season, they're the better team. No question. They're 26-16 on the season. Are you surprised that the line is so close, and does that tell us anything?
Yeah, I think it tells us that somebody may know something in Vegas. You know, they always are really tricky there. And the fact that they play last night, they had to play all four quarters to the very end. They only won by 1 point in Utah. And with James Harden playing 38 minutes last night, I have my reservations if he's going to play tonight or not. And the same with Tobias Harris. I'm just not 100% sure. So I think that's going into the factor in the line here. The fact that also Lakers have had some rest. They haven't played in a couple nights. They're at home. They have shown some life despite Anthony Davis not being there. So I think all those things are in play here. And that is why I actually do like the Lakers to cover the spread +3. I think they have a really good chance of actually winning this game as well.
Yeah, I mean, they certainly could. One of the concerns I've got, you know, Thomas Bryant has been great. Been absolutely fantastic for the Lakers, but defensively, that is not his forte. It's not his strong suit. Again, I'm not holding against him. It's not what you brought him in to be, but that's a tough matchup, asking Thomas Bryant to defend Joel Embiid. That could be enough of a – there could be enough of a monstrous Embiid performance tonight that the Lakers may not be able to pull away, but we'll see. And again, Tyrese Maxey can certainly fill in for James Harden, so that by no means – is this a game where I say, okay, the Lakers clearly have an advantage here? Like I said, the Pistons are a 3-point favorite currently. I'm sorry, the 76ers are a 3-point favorite currently, and for good reason. But I do wonder, like you're saying, if you get an emotional win the night before, sometimes it's hard to keep that energy level ramped up. And I wonder if tonight's going to be an opportunity for the Lakers to come in with energy, come out angry after that Mavs loss, and get the job done here. This would be big for the Lakers if you could get this win. Are there any player props or anything like that you're looking at? I know a lot of things are still up in the air with the uncertainty around Harden and Tobias Harris.
Yeah, it's kind of tough right now. You're looking at the lines. They have LeBron's overall points at 31.5. Don't really love that number considering you got Embiid in the middle. We know LeBron does a lot of his damage driving the paint, so I'm not really confident in that one. You look at Joel Embiid, they got his points right now. The over's at 33.5. I would probably take a stab at that, to be honest with you. I know it's a lot of points, a lot of juice there, but considering they could be down a couple guys, and then Thomas Bryant is not the best defender in the world, not the biggest guy, like you kind of alluded to. I could see Embiid having one of those special nights. So I will take a look there at the over. And even Westbrook's points, is that right now it's at 17.5. I think he could probably take advantage there with the second unit, especially if the Sixers are a little bit shorthanded, which I have a weird feeling they might be tonight, considering the heavy minutes that was played last night.
Yeah, I'm sure they're going to try to refrain from announcing it, you know, too early. They have all the way up until 30 minutes prior to tip-off whether or not Harden or Harris will play in this one. But if one or both of them are out, certainly that would help the Lakers' cause. Russell Westbrook, 28 points last game against the Mavs. Now, obviously, that was a double overtime game, so that certainly can be a factor. But, yeah, I don't mind that line either. I mean, look at the last three games for Russ. He's 23, 25, 28. And what's that, 17.5 for Russ tonight?
Yeah, I think that actually, now that you're kind of talking about it more, it's probably my favorite play of the night, actually. So, yeah.
It's five in a row. He's hit the over on that now. Five in a row. He only covered it by – he hit 18 against Atlanta on the sixth, but five in a row that he's gone over 17.5 points for Russell Westbrook.
Well, it sounds like you are talking yourself into it.
I am.
So let's make that an official. I'm going to officially play Russell Westbrook's overall points tonight at 17.5. Like Trevor Lane just said, he's covered that total in his last five games. He's playing in a good rhythm right now. He's playing a good pace. His confidence is there. And I really believe tonight, after having a few nights of rest, going against a team that just played a tough, tough, hard physical game last night in Utah, I can see him taking advantage tonight. Give me Russell Westbrook's over points, 17.5. There you go.
All right. I like it. Of course, the most important thing, can the Lakers get a win? Trying to tread water without Anthony Davis. AD could be back sometime in the next week or so, maybe. We could be getting towards that territory where we're looking at maybe a little bit more for Anthony Davis to come back. Hopefully before the big East Coast road trip at the end of January, we could see AD back in action. So we've heard he's back out there at practice. Can the Lakers pick up some wins in the meantime and get themselves in position to make some noise once AD does actually return to the floor? Lakers Nation, give us your thoughts on the Bogdanovic and Noel trade possibility. Is that something you would do if you are Rob Pelinka and the Los Angeles Lakers? And what are your thoughts on Lakers versus 76ers tonight? Till next time, everybody, stay safe and see you.